The bloody shed.
No. I don't know.
No, we got to work on an intro. We don't have a good intro.
That was good.
You think that was a good intro?
I think that was...
We'll let the audience know. You guys let us know if that one works or if we need to work on it. Actually, maybe we don't want to hear what
I don't want to know. No. Well, we're kind of goofballs, so that's okay.
That's true. So you have a good weekend so far?
I had a good weekend. Also, I forgot to tell you, I brought your unicorn sippy cup to you.
Oh, my sippy cup. Yes. Can't get anything on the electronics, but we must have our alcohol.
Yeah. So there's your cocktail and your unicorn sippy cup. So what's going on?
Not a hell of a lot. I got sunstroke yesterday, but I mean, that'll make this kind of an interesting podcast, right?
It was warm. We're hitting spring. It's funny because I just saw someone mention that I think they were in like Virginia or somewhere out there, and it was like 28 degrees yesterday, and I think it was in the low 80s here.
Yeah. Wow. Okay. Must be nice to enjoy. Well, but we don't have to deal with the snow. You can't.
No.
They always say, I hate this line, but they always say you can't shovel sunshine. So that's why all the snow.
People say that?
Yeah. That's why the snowbirds
can't
come here.
Shovel sunshine.
Well, okay. Maybe they have the toothless sounding thing going.
Can't shovel sunshine.
You're starting to sound like my family. Oh, so I have a quote for you.
Okay.
So you know who Lon Chaney is?
Yes.
Senior, the first Lon Chaney.
Okay.
So he said he had a quote about clowns.
He did?
Yeah. He said a clown is funny in the circus ring, but what would be the normal reaction to opening a door at midnight and finding the same clown standing there in the moonlight?
In the moonlight. Mm-hmm. That is, that's everyone. Well, I can't say everyone, but that's a lot of people's nightmare, unless you're like some weird fetish person or something.
Is there? I wonder if there's a clown fetish.
I don't know. I just thought of that.
Why did we not research clown fetish?
I'm sure it exists. It has to exist.
Clown fetish.
I mean, if people like to suck toes, I'm sure there's people that like clowns.
I don't understand the toe sucking thing. I don't get it.
I don't either.
But there is a word. So it's kind of a weird thing. There is a word that we've adopted for the fear of clowns. You claim you have a little fear of clowns.
It's not as bad as it used to be, but I think I've outgrown it a little bit, but I'm not a fan of clowns, but I've known people that have a huge phobia of clowns.
I think you do better than you always thought you did, because I mean, don't you remember the great clown bake of of O2?
I just remembered that today, and I think that actually kind of cured my clown phobia.
Oh, really?
A little bit.
I was a weird. I remember it was the Halloween that in Arizona, Phoenix. Sometimes you can't tell if it's going to be a hot Halloween or a cold Halloween. I chose unwisely. So I remember sitting next to the campfire.
Is that your loincloth?
Yes,
Halloween?
I went with, as a headhunter, and all I had was a loincloth and baby heads around me.
A headhunter.
And
terrible.
I look over, and you're surrounded by like three clowns
passing. No, it was like 10 clowns.
No, that's it.
Yes, it was a lot. There was
what that is? Is that your memory adding a clown for every year since?
No, because it was between 5 and 10 because there was a circus in town, and they all ended up at this house at this party we were at. But it was definitely,
and they were passing around getting baked off of a joint or a pipe or something.
And then my other memory, the whole day was weird, but there was also, because it had been raining all day, the hosts of the party had covered the backyard.
Oh, that's right.
That stuff, that sawdust stuff.
Yeah,
that
we felt like giant gerbils.
Yeah,
it was
the stuff
sawdust
you put in cages.
Yeah.
And so
cedar chips.
I was hanging out with this group of clowns, and they were all getting high. And then I remember grabbing a handful of this, like, cage batting stuff, whatever it's called, like, you know, and we all started like sort of throwing it at each other. It was a really weird night.
I don't remember that.
Yeah,
but
it was a strange night.
Maybe some of the fumes were wafting
over.
But they
were professional clowns. They weren't just like dressed like clowns for Halloween. They were actual professional clowns.
Were they? Well, I mean, clowns have a right to get stoned too.
Sure. I don't have a problem with it, but it was a weird night.
So you know the word for the fear of clowns?
It's like someone with a C-O.
Yeah, coulrophobia.
How do you say that?
Some people say coulrophobia. Oh, okay. Some people say coulrophobia. I can't even say it right now. Coulrophobia.
So that's right? Like the phobia of clowns.
Yes.
Like the fear of heights, fear of like claustrophobia, all of that. It's right. Kind of the same
if
thing.
If it really existed. So yes, there are people that have a fear of clowns, but it's not actually a recognized phobia. It's not the medical phobia.
So you can't get anxiety medication for it,
no.
Unless you work for the circus, maybe.
I mean, the first problem is coulrophobia. It's a word. If you look online, people will try to claim that it comes from Greek and some obscure word about stilt walkers or whatever. And it's all bullshit. The word is just completely made up. It just popped up on the internet radar sometime in the 90s and just became this word. Mm. So it's not even not technically a real thing. And
it's interesting how this like fear of clowns and these evil clowns have just sort of slowly become more and more part of pop culture and more part of like, you know, mainstream phobia.
Mm-hmm.
And there's always been like a weird association with clowns. Like I can remember as a child, like being kind of creeped out by clowns and had friends that were creeped out, but it's just become more and more mainstream.
Mm-hmm. I think for us, it makes sense for us. I mean, there's a long history of clowns and a little bit of a creepy factor to them, but I think for us, we're of a generation that it hit us in media.
Yeah.
Right? We were at a young, impressionable age watching a movie where some poor kid's getting dragged by a clown
doll
under the bed.
I remember that being a big factor for a lot of people's fear of clowns. But right. I can also say just Bozo the Clown and Ronald McDonald, they're pretty creepy.
Right. Well, what's his name? So the guy that he was in Police Academy. He was also Shakes the Clown.
Oh,
Bobcat Goldthwait.
Yeah. I love his clown movie. What was that movie called?
Shakes the Clown.
Yeah, Shakes the Clown. Yeah,
Shakes the Clown.
Yeah, that's a great movie. I love it.
And so he has a quote that I think is the most appropriate thing I've heard. Most people get nervous when they see a clown because clowns give off this vibe that they're going to make you touch their penis.
What the hell? That's never occurred to me in my life.
Really?
No.
Oh, well, I mean.
What?
I wouldn't have thought so either until I read the story of Klutzo the Clown, but I'm not going to go into Klutzo the Clown.
Klutzo?
No, he's Canada 1973 kids.
Oh,
yeah, we'll go there.
Okay.
But
super gross.
I'm going to talk about Crotchy the Clown. Crotchy the Clown.
Okay.
Yeah. You ready for him? Scott Harold. By day, he's a school bus driver, and I think he like a couple of jobs on the side, washing and stuff like that. But at nighttime, so around 1994, he decided to do a public access show. So he submits. This is in Nebraska, and he puts together a show he calls Cosmic Comedy.
This was like pre-podcast. People used to...
Yeah, they used public access.
Right, and you could... I think it was like $200 or $500, and you could have your own public access show on this random channel at midnight or whatever.
Right.
Yeah.
Right, and so his was kind of... It was a little weird, but 6 months goes by, and he has to renew his contract, right? So he puts in a request, I want the midnight time slot. And on the application, it says it's going to feature sexual and or excretory activities and organs and include adult movie reviews.
Okay. Mm-hmm. In Nebraska.
And he got away with it.
I mean, nothing wrong with Nebraska, but it just seems a little, conservative.
He got away with it for about 3 months till he sort of crossed the line. It's September 14th, 1995.
What was his name? Crotchy?
Crotchy the Clown, is a.k.a. Scott Harold.
Okay.
Yeah. And so he delivers his episode to the studio in September of that year. And the contents of the videotape are 14 minutes of Harold as a costumed weirdo named Cosblah, making strange faces and rambling noises. Like, it's all filtered, so you can't even understand what he's saying. And then it's followed by a little over a minute of him reclining, with clown makeup and dark sunglasses on and nothing else. and masturbating.
Great.
Right. And so his masturbation is introduced by a voiceover dialogue, a bunch of garbled, incomprehensible nonsense.
This sounds like an art project.
Well, who knows? He was quoted later saying that he did this because one of his followers, a woman, was complaining that there wasn't enough male nudity. So he decided he's going to do this crazy bushy black beard and clown makeup and dark sunglasses jacking off for a minute and a half.
And they aired it?
They aired it two nights in a row.
Oh.
But we'll give them the credit that they aired it, but they did call the cops. So the cops, they brought him in and it went to court. And so the reason we know all of what's in this is because the Nebraska Supreme Court had to watch this. Because several of his videos, they were all just wrong. And the reason they had to watch is because they had an overturn a ruling from the state court of appeals that had said the show was, yes, bizarre and disgusting, but not technically obscene.
Really?
Yes. So they had to overturn it, and he was fined $1,000. And that's the last we heard of
Crotchy
the Clown.
Crusty Crotchy.
But Nebraska, for a couple of nights, they did have to see him...
masturbating.
Auditioning his hand puppet.
Oh, really? Really?
Scratching Yoda behind the ears?
Oh my gosh. What the hell?
Shaking hands with the unemployed?
Stop it. The unemployed?
Mugging Jesus in the alley?
What? Where are you getting this? Who are
okay,
you?
Okay, having a staff meeting.
Stop it. Where are you getting? Did you make that up?
I don't know.
No. You're as weird as he is. We're going to have, they're going to be knocking on our door.
I'm actually blushing on radio. That's weird.
That vein on your head is sticking out.
Okay. So do you want to know a little bit of the history? I can lay some history on you.
Sure.
Okay. So
we should warn people, if you do have this actual phobia, you might want to turn your radio down.
Should we have a disclaimer? Those who are faint of clown right. Should look away.
Or get alive.
So the modern origins of the bad clown idea, it's kind of an unclear origin, but clowns have been around forever. For all the way back to Greek times.
Yeah, I think I saw some reference to even like in the Egyptian time mm-hmm. where they weren't called clowns, but there was...
In ancient Rome, they were actually called stupidus.
Stupidus.
Yeah. and one variety of clown has a really dark origin, and it came to be known as a harlequin. But it was originally, the origins are in mythology and folklore. It was a creature in folklore that eventually Jacob Grimm, like Grimm's fairy tales, he called it the wild hunt. And the folklore is older, and it's basically the idea of fairies, demons, dead people, whatever. They would be flying past you in mad chase of something, hunting something down, right? Mm-hmm. And they were usually led by some whatever, you know, monstrous, you know, Odin or Krampus or the devil, or, you know, just something. And if you saw it, it was a bad omen, you know, war or whatever. That's, of course, I'm assuming.
I would think it would be more than a bad omen.
Bad omen. Well, I mean, that's if they're not chasing you, right? So eventually, in French versions of this, it was called House of Helicon. And the leader, Helicon, was one of the devil's emissaries, I guess. And in some of the legends, as they evolved, the demon was a trickster. So it sort of evolved into this character, the Harlequin. And it became a character in popular French comedy of art plays around like the 1500s. And they would often be wearing red and black. So if you ever notice, Harlequin clowns are always wearing red and black.
And, or mimes.
Yeah.
Too.
Well, mimes
that's
are
a different
whole,
thing.
We're going to do an episode on mimes. Okay. We have to. Those creep me out.
Oh, really?
Okay, not really,
they
but they're a little
in the 70s. Really? Okay. Yeah. Anyway.
And so they would be on stage reenacting things, and they would have this, like a, it looked like a little sword or paddle, right? And so here's a little word origin for you, right? They would take this paddle and they would hit people mm-hmm. with this on stage because I guess, you know.
Because that's hilarious.
Well, I mean, we look at all the YouTube videos. It must be pretty funny. But it would actually, they weren't hitting him as hard as it looked. It was actually two pieces of wood that would slap.
Oh, it makes the sound.
Right. It was a slapstick.
Oh.
And so that's where the origin of the word slapstick, like slapstick
humor. Oh,
that's
funny. I didn't know that.
Right. That's where it comes from. So, you know, harlequins and clowns, court jesters, are just kind of, they work their way through the history. We all know the court jester that got away with saying shit to the king.
Right. I was just going to bring that up. That's an interesting historical piece because they could get away with criticizing the king and making these sort of like social commentaries where no one else could. And it was
well, there's a couple funny. Of reasons. I'm not sure if I believe entirely this, but one of the quoted reasons for this was that at the time they thought idiots were divine. Like, because I mean, if you're going to say something like that, you must be really stupid or, I don't know, maybe divinely stupid or something like that. So they kept him around as a protection from evil.
Really?
I don't get the logic of that, but I'll call it freedom of speech at its finest, right?
Wow, that's interesting.
So let's pull it into the modern days. So anyone who's a clown listening to this would be offended if I don't mention Joseph Grimaldi.
Okay.
So he is like the patron saint, the king of clowns.
The king of clowns.
Everything visually and conceptually you think of about a clown, the modern day clown, that comes from him. This is in the 1700s.
Okay. I was just going to ask.
Yeah. But so then the other side of things also happened because he was a professional clown on stage and stuff. I mean, he was pretty much the actor of the day, whatever the big actor is right now. He was the actor.
He was the Brad Pitt.
He was the Brad Pitt of
clowns?
The 1700s. No, oh. all together.
Oh, all together.
Because they were
okay.
more integral. Like comedy, I think, was more integral to theater at the time.
Okay.
You know, but he also, you know, his son and his wife died young. He was a penniless, drunken mess when he died in 1837. Like nothing about his life went right. He was just a horrible mess. So at the same time, Charles Dickens, he had been writing some stuff called the Pickwick Papers.
Uh-huh.
And in it,
I love Dickens.
There's like a serial story of just all these crazy adventures. And in it, there's a clown who was an alcoholic mess. Sound familiar?
Right.
And a failing health mess under the whole thing. And of course, he even ended up writing Grimaldi's biography after Grimaldi died. But you start getting the idea, like, what's
where
creepy
the
about
change
clowns?
Like the image of the clown started to change as far as like
right.
the public.
I don't know.
Image
did it start
or
change or did people just start making theater from things that are, I mean, when you show up with makeup, it's weird because I don't know what's the reality underneath that makeup.
Well, right. And I was just reading about like, it's not actually a Freudian theory about clowns, but there's people that have used this theory, this Freudian theory. He called it the uncanny. And so, and of course I'm just like totally cliff noting it here and paraphrasing, but it's basically because when you first see something, your mind, your lower brain interprets it before it hits like your full consciousness. And if it's familiar but doesn't make sense, you make an interpretation that can also create like a phobia or a fear, and it could be irrational.
Mm-hmm.
So that kind of like links in. So with a clown, with their sad face or their happy face makeup or even sad face makeup, but then underneath it is like the actual face, you're making an interpretation based on reality that isn't making sense. So you're by the time it gets to your consciousness, you've already made like an interpretation of it.
Wow. I mean, I tend to not really buy much of Freud's ideas, but that, I don't know, that one kind of makes sense
to
me.
Well, it's a loose interpretation here, but I think it's really interesting because it does kind of explain why it gives you this sort of uncomfortable feeling when you first look at a clown.
Right.
For a lot of people anyway.
So I know another famous person that totally developed the idea of the scary clown.
Who?
So our good friend Edgar Allan Poe.
Our good friend. Okay.
I don't know. I would hang out with him. Wouldn't you?
I don't know.
Okay. I mean, it would be lots of...
I think he's super interesting, but he sounds like kind
he
of
sounds
a...
sounds way too serious at times, you know?
He like, sounds a, yeah, like...
A few drinks in, he'd be like talking serious shit.
Yeah, high maintenance.
I would still drink with him. But he wrote a story called Hopfrog.
Okay.
And it's...
I'm not super familiar with Poe, so...
Oh, okay. So it's said to be inspired by something called the Ball of the Burning Mint, literally. So to go back to the story, this isn't clowns, but he totally changes the story. And it's just, wow. So at a French masquerade ball, 1393, King Charles and his entourage of five men were performing a dance. They dressed up in costumes to look like wild men, you know, like savages and demons and stuff. It was just this weird masquerade ball, and they'd kind of thrown it to keep him distracted. It seems like it was a really bad idea because he had done lost his shit the year before. He had a history in his whole life of mental instability, which is always what we want in a king, right?
Right. So, well, they probably didn't have a choice. They had to just keep him around.
Yeah, yeah. So they're dressed up in these costumes, and the costumes were made of linen, and they had covered them with resin and flax, all this stuff to make them look shaggy, right? Look like wild creatures.
Okay.
And they were also flammable.
Oh.
Right? So they were dancing around, taunting people to guess who they were, right? Because it was a masquerade ball. And King Charles' brother, he shows up with a friend, and they're drunk off their asses, walking, carrying a torch in the room. And despite an order, they weren't even supposed to have torches. He walks over, he leans close to look at someone and shines the torch in the guy's face to try and identify who it is.
Oh, no.
And whoosh, sets dude's leg on fire.
Oh, my gosh.
So he's flailing. He catches all the other resin-coated idiots on fire. Everyone goes up in flames. The king and some other dude actually survived because they happened to be standing just far enough away.
Party faux pas.
Oh, yeah. And so what the hell does this have to do with clowns? Well, in 1849, Edgar Allan Poe, he started writing Hopfrog, and he basically used that story, but he turned it into a little person, and he becomes a jester at the king's court. His name is Hopfrog, and he has a friend, and the king torments them. So, and hits his friend's Trippetta, another little person, and the two of them, they talk the court into dressing up as orangutans, right?
Really?
Wild men. And chained together, I mean, I don't know how this would ever happen in the real world, but suspend your disbelief, for a late night masquerade, and then they trap them in the room, pull a rope, suspend them in the air, set them on fire, and run away while everyone else burns to death.
Wow.
Edgar Allan Poe. You sure you don't want to drink with Edgar Allan Poe?
No.
So, yeah, the clowns killed the king.
Oh, I see.
Yeah.
Huh. Interesting. Interesting. So the evil clowns had begun, or, you know, like the concept of evil clowns.
Yeah, I think that pretty much set the stage. And I mean, there's little things through history, but I think, you know, like you said about
I wonder too,
Freud.
Like sociologically, or, you know, like the idea of being treated as an idiot and an outcast and then turning that into revenge, you know, like, just the concept of like, okay, you're a clown and that's how people treat you. And then you sort of like turn your revenge on everyone that has mistreated you.
So here's the interesting thing that you say that. So going back to Lon Chaney, the reason he had some relevance to talk about clowns is in the couple of years, he died in 1930, but in the couple of years before that, he made these two movies of tragic clowns. And the first one was called He Who Gets Slapped. And it's a full-length movie with, I forget what her name is. There's a well-known actress in it as well. And he's basically a scientist who's made a discovery about mankind. And he's talking to his wife and a baron about his idea. And he goes to present before all of the scientists. And then the baron shows up, steals his idea, tries to confront him, and he gets slapped down literally and figuratively, the audience is laughing at him. He goes to his wife to console him. She slaps him, and she's also in an affair with a baron. And so he decides to become a masochist and becomes a clown, and then runs into them years later. You know, there's a whole bunch of like a tryst of relationships, and he's jilted again and kills them by trapping him in a room with a lion.
I like this.
Yeah, it's actually, I mean, it's a silent movie, and I don't like silent movies.
And oh, you don't?
I actually watched this one all the way through.
I think visually it's really super cool.
Yeah, what I sent you was just a little clip of it. Yeah. Somebody montaged it together or something.
Well, there's a really great movie in the late 50s or early 60s with Jimmy Stewart, where he's a clown. Like he was a physician, and then he was involved in a murder, and then he's runs away with the circus basically to hide out. Do you know that movie? It won like a bunch of Academy Awards and stuff. I'm trying to remember. I was going to look up the name of it, but I can't remember the name. I think it's called like Ringling Brothers or something like that. But so, and he's like this really depressed clown and this kind of alcoholic, sad clown, but he's hiding from the law basically as a clown.
Interesting.
But I think he won an Academy Award for that role as a clown. Huh.
I see. I think the circus is more freaky than clowns.
The circus overall?
Yeah, overall. I mean, I one of my favorite movies, of course, you watch it later, it's not as good, but I loved Something Wicked This Way Comes.
I don't think I've ever seen that.
Oh, really? No. Oh, I loved that when I was a kid.
Oh,
yeah.
Really? I don't think I've seen that movie. One.
I forget who was in it now, but okay, so we have to talk about this, but I really don't want to.
Uh-oh.
John Wayne Gacy.
Okay, why don't you want to talk about it?
Because I don't think he qualifies in a conversation about bad clowns.
But if you are having a conversation about evil clowns, his name comes up.
His name comes up all the time. But I first of all, everyone talks about him, and it's such a minor factor. It wasn't part of his murders.
No, it wasn't part of his murders, but he did perform as a clown, and he did do clown paint clown portraits, and it is part.
He made money off of it in prison.
Yeah, but it is part of his legacy.
True. I mean, so for anyone, if there's a listener out there who might be living under a rock for the last 40 years, John Wayne Gacy, because I'm sure everyone knows who he is, right? He murdered at least 33 teenage boys, young men between 72 and 78. This is in Illinois, and his downfall was when he broke his protocol, because he was always going after waifs or you know, boys that were working the streets and stuff like that.
He would hire these young men,
right?
Because he was like a contractor. Yeah.
But then I think where he screwed up is that he went for somebody that more people would care about, and they wouldn't say, oh, another runaway. So he killed Rob Peast, and then the cops believed parents that said, hey, my son's missing, or they hadn't really bought that story before on anyone.
Well, and the thing too with him is that he would host these sort of like he was well known for these backyard barbecue parties that he would host for all the neighborhood. And meanwhile, a lot of these boys were buried in the basement while these parties were going on. And I think, too, there's stories about him being dressed as a clown and hosting parties for some of the kids and things like that.
Right. And it's crazy. There's numerous chances that people could have stopped him because he had been arrested. He'd served time for sodomizing a teenager, like, I don't know, what, 10, 15 years before all of this.
He was one of those guys that was charming enough and affiliated enough as far as like with, you know, he was well known within the neighborhood. He had ties to some government officials that people just couldn't fathom that he would be involved in anything like that.
Yeah, there's like the one thing that, doing a little research, the one thing that I didn't know that like popped out in my mind. Yeah, he was in the Democratic Party.
Oh, no, I thought he was a Republican.
No, he was in the Democratic Party. Oh. But there's a picture of him with Rosalynn Carter.
Mm-hmm. I've seen that, yeah.
Oh, really?
I swear I thought he was involved with the Republicans. Either way,
yeah,
the guy was a freaking creep.
Can we hang this on some party, political party?
Well, no, it's not that. It's just, I think, didn't he like run for office? I don't know.
Oh, I don't know. He didn't stand a chance because they knew something was up, and they didn't even find Rob Peast at his house. It was basically they knew something was up because he had, like you said, he was trying to hire him for contractor work. And so they go and they find all these trophies, and there were trophies from other disappearing kids. And it didn't help that the house smelled like dead bodies. So they pull up the crawl space. And he's running around and he's like doing a goodbye tour to all of the people, his friends and stuff. And so the cops arrest him before he, you know, offs himself and takes all the secrets to the grave. And that's pretty much the cliff notes.
Like really the only sort of like serial killer clown, like when you look at this in terms of like scary clowns and you know, mm-hmm. pop culture history or whatever. Like, that's really the only one that kind of comes up as far as like an actual serial killer clown. But we've had other clowns that have murdered, even though technically not a clown. But there's a story that happened in 1990 in Florida in a town called Wellington. And so Marlene Warren was married to Michael Warren, and Michael Warren was doing really well at this point in his life, and they owned a house in this sort of golf community, and also the community, it was one of the first areas that had an airport within the neighborhood, like a runway.
I want that.
A lot of the houses had these hangar garages, and so it was a really well-to-do neighborhood, and Michael Warren owned a used car business, basically. And also they repoed cars and him a little bit of not such a on the up and up business handling is going on as well.
He was a used car salesman, so.
Mm. Yeah. Well, he had this woman working for him named Sheila Keene. And there was gossip and rumors that something was going on between the two of them. She was a repo woman for him, which is takes a specific type of personality to do that.
That's a ballsy job.
Yeah. So in 1990, on May 26th in 1990, Marlene was at home with her teen daughter and son and some of his friends, and they had just made breakfast and everyone was just kind of hanging out, enjoying the day. And a knock on the door, and Marlene answered the door, and there was a clown standing there with an orange wig and a red nose and clown makeup, clown outfit, holding balloons and flowers, and didn't say a word, but shot Marlene in the face.
Mm.
And the son, heard it happen, and he was in a cast at the time. He had a broken leg, and he went running after the clown to try to, you know, chase the clown down, but the clown escaped in this Chrysler. And nobody knew who it was. But 3 hours later, there was a tip, an anonymous tip to the police saying that it was Sheila Keene that worked for Marlene's husband, Michael. So they did actually go to her house and speak to her and looked through her apartment. And they did find some evidence, but not enough to do anything. So it wasn't until 30 years later that Sheila was arrested for the murder of Marlene. And by this point, her and Michael had married.
Right.
And they had moved to Virginia and opened a restaurant called The Purple Cow. And reportedly, they were not good bosses. The people that worked for them said they liked them as people, but they were not good bosses.
Clowns kept showing up and killing them off.
Well, no. But Sheila had a bad temper, and she would often get drunk with the employees. And a lot of them they didn't believe her. They didn't know what to believe, but she had sort of boasted or talked about killing Michael's first wife while she was dressed as a clown.
Why do they always, you know, stop thinking you can get away with boasting about this?
Well, and the whole story is just so bizarre. But Michael, between then and him marrying, so he married Sheila in 2002, but between his wife being murdered and then marrying Sheila, he had served 4 years in prison for just fraud, basically. But so then they opened this restaurant in Virginia, or I think it was Virginia, or I think it was Virginia. But so it was 30 years later in 2017 that she got arrested through DNA evidence.
Which is weird to me. Like, what, the clown couldn't have left hardly anything behind.
I don't know exactly what the DNA evidence was, but
it was a hair sample I saw, but I don't know.
Was it a hair sample? Yeah, but there was so much other evidence, and even the cost, the owner of the costume store where she bought the clown costume. Mm-hmm. I guess she came in like urgently and said, "I need to buy this costume." They were about to close, and so they remembered her because she was kind of rude about the whole thing and made them stay late so that she could buy this costume. And they found orange fibers, like wig fibers, in her apartment. And also at one point, there was a guy that had worked for Michael Warren that on his deathbed confessed to his son where to find the car, the white Chrysler. And the gun, I guess he helped get rid of it in a canal. And so then once his father died, he told the police where to find the car and the gun, and they found it.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
I know one little nugget is like years and a few months before the murder happened, that her son had been had some legal issues. He and some punks had beat up and damn near killed somebody. And at the courthouse, unrelated to this, Michael asked one of the attorneys or somebody, like just point blank, while Marlene is there, asked, you know, if somebody wanted to kill their wife for the money, how would they get away with it?
Are you serious?
And the guy regrets to this day that he said, well, it would have to be a disguise that someone you couldn't tell if it was a man or a woman, like a clown costume.
Oh my gosh. Yeah. Well, and then also because Marlene was fascinated with clowns when she was young, and she used to paint portraits of clowns, and her mom still has them. But and actually she was really talented. She was a good artist. But so it's just the whole thing is really eerie about Marlene was fat. And maybe that's why Sheila dressed as a clown. Maybe she knew Marlene's fascination with clowns. I don't know. But yeah, so the most current news in that case is that they did end up taking the death penalty off the table because they feel that the evidence is too old.
Yeah, well, because I think they still haven't even taken this to court yet, have
they? No, well, she was supposed to go to court in May of 2019, but then now it was pushed back because they're fighting over whether or not they can seek the death penalty. Mm-hmm. But
I see.
Because the evidence, her attorneys were able to convince the court that the evidence is too old, so now, I think the trial was supposed to start in January of this year, but I don't know anything more current than that.
Clown came a knocking and packing heat.
But this, and then if you think about it, so that was in 1990, and then now her children have had to survive all of this.
It's 30 years.
Exactly. They've had to survive everything since then of this, the new clown, the terror clown that has happened since then. You know what I mean? Like that's
so
a really difficult thing to go through.
So to touch on that, I mean, that's like, I think we should maybe talk about hysterias in an episode, but just to briefly go through that. So there's this weird phenomenon. It started, as best as I can tell, in England, a small town in England, there was a filmmaker who started just going and sitting on corners and freaking people out and saying lines from It and stuff. And he was eventually found out who it was. He was just being silly. But then within months, there was a company in Staten Island. So in US, they did the same thing, right? And then it pops up again in France, a bunch of copycats. But then it snowballed. And like there were clowns showing up everywhere in France.
Oh, yeah.
And then all of a sudden there were criminals taking advantage of this, what was supposed to be creepy, but sort of innocent.
Right. Like I think it started out as kind of this, like this creepy, but innocent prank of like just scaring people and just, you know, being weird, but I'm not sure why people were doing it, but yeah. And then so, but people then would start dressing more and more as clowns, like robbing banks and all kinds of stuff.
Man, that's...
But yeah, the clown, I think a lot of that started in, was it like 2016, 2017 when it got like huge, where there was like reported almost nightly on the news, like more clown sightings and clown sightings everywhere.
You know what? I bet they were.
Mom.
Oh yeah, they were totally what do they call them again?
Juggalos
who had nothing left to do.
The juggalos. Yeah, I don't think that. Well, maybe they were juggalos, but no?
Oh, do we need to explain juggalos?
So juggalos are fans of Insane Clown Posse. And Insane Clown Posse, if you don't know, is, I didn't really know, they're a hip hop band on a Psychopathic Records label, but
All right. You do you know any? How much do you know about juggalos?
Juggalos. So I want to run by. I'm going to test you on your knowledge of juggalo terms.
Okay, juggalo terms. They have. What do you mean terms? Like they have their own language?
They
Klingon?
Do. They basically have like there's a full dictionary of juggalo terms that goes from A to Z. And
lingo.
I didn't count how many terms there are, but there's a lot.
Juggalingo.
There's, yeah, basically. So, I mean, if you're not familiar, like, with all of the, like, the juggalo sort of, you know, what do you call it? Like, their own, they have their own subculture.
Sub, all from one stupid band?
Well, you better be careful, because they can be violent.
Okay. All from one band? Sorry, I just threw in the stupid.
All right, so a blue neck. What do you think a blue neck is?
Blue neck. Somebody who's been suffocated.
No, it's when a juggalo is rocking so hard at the carnival that their makeup starts to run down their neck.
Okay.
There's actually a lot of really gross sort of references in here, gross juggalo terms, but I'm going to try to go a little bit
PG-13. Oh, no, why do you got to do that?
Okay. What do you think a clown job is?
Clown job?
Actually, no, we need to back up because first of all, do you know what a popsicle is?
Popsicle. A popsicle is where... No, I don't know. I give up. I'm not going to
Basically, that's their term for a penis.
Oh, of course. Okay.
Okay. So then a clown job...
is when you let someone suck your popsicle.
Basically, yes.
Okay.
But there's more to it. Oh. It's the act of performing fellatio on a fellow juggalo or juggalette, causing your makeup to color their popsicle.
Juggalette. Okay.
So your juggalo makeup or juggalette makeup, whichever your situation may be.
Oh, okay.
Colors the popsicle.
Okay. Because clowns
because your makeup is wearing off on the
like red and blue. It's so you basically turn it into one of those. What was that one that you always get the
bullet?
The bullet at the ice
cream.
Yeah. Okay. So, but
you say like my ninja, she just gave you a straight clown job. That's what they reference here.
You sounded like a housewife saying that,
well,
though.
Yeah, I mean, I'm not familiar with this.
So, but what about women? I mean, that's for dudes.
Well,
somebody goes...
I mean, it can go either way.
Yeah?
Because the juggalos and the juggalettes wear makeup, so it can go either way. Okay, so what do you think is a juffalo?
A juffalo. A juffalo. That's a really rough... Juggalo.
It's just a fake juggalo.
Oh,
there's several terms in here for fake juggalos.
Faux juggalo?
Yeah.
Okay.
And then, let's see, a magalo?
Magalo? There's maggots involved in this.
A maggot or Slipknot fan?
A slip...
I don't even know really what that means.
You worried about juggalos, and now we've got Slipknot fans going to chase us down.
Right? All right, we'll just do one more here.
Okay.
Shazbot.
I like that. What is Shazbot?
Oh, fuck? That's their term for oh, fuck.
Oh, really? Like, something goes wrong. Shazbot.
I thought that was from Mork and Mindy. Like, Mork from Mork would say Shazbot.
Did he?
Yeah. They stole that from Mork and Mindy.
That's copyright infringement.
Shazbot. Remember when Robin Williams would say, oh, Shazbot?
No, I don't remember Shazbot.
Well, I'm a total nerd, and I do. Okay, anyway, so...
Okay.
We have that's our little test on your juggalo dictionary knowledge, and you failed.
I totally failed. Okay,
but
well.
There's one of us in this room that has dressed up as a clown at one point.
I have.
And it wasn't me.
I have failed as a clown, not just a juggalo.
An Insane Clown Posse show. You did it all on your own.
Not all on my own. There was. I was inspired.
There was romance involved.
Well, attempted romance.
Because that's what you do when you're first in love. When you get that first little flutter in your heart, and what you want to do is put a clown suit on.
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, some people call it stalking, but...
Oh, no. I don't know if you
okay,
were...
Okay, that didn't come out right.
Yeah,
I don't think you were stalking.
No.
She told me...
I think if you did it twice, that would be stalking.
Oh, right, okay. She told me a girl that I liked, and we were hanging out, and she told me... So if you're out there, I'm going to tell the story, and I apologize. Here's my official apology.
If she's listening, she's stalking you.
Well, so... She told me at some point, I'm pretty sure all the years have gone by, she said, I like clowns.
She probably said, I despise clowns.
I know, and I distinctly heard like. Okay. Maybe I heard wrong.
Maybe.
And separately, she also mentioned her birthday.
Okay.
And so I thought, you know what? I'm going to woo this girl.
Woo her.
I was young and stupid. And I thought it would be a great idea. I knew she worked at a jewelry store in the mall. This was up at Arrowhead. It was like the Arrowhead Mall had just opened.
It sounds like a scene from a weird indie movie.
So I thought, you know what? I'm going to surprise her for her birthday. So I...
Not with candy. Not with balloons.
No. Well, yeah, it was a bouquet. I was going to bring her a bouquet of flowers.
Okay.
So I stopped at Bert Easley's, which is a costume store.
Because that's when you're falling in love. That's the first place you go.
Yeah, the Halloween store. And I got a clown costume. The big cheesy green plastic shoes and everything. And I put it on. Of course, I had to take the shoes off. And halfway there, I realized, oh, I got to put gas in the car. So everyone is looking at me horrified as I hop out of the car and I'm running around. Totally hamming it up and putting gas.
Was it those shoes that squeak when you walk? Where you're like,
no, I couldn't afford those. They were just the big clumpy plastic ones, you know, the $10 shoes. And so I put gas in my tank and I drove all the way out to Arrowhead and I went clomping through the mall. And I walk in and into a classy jewelry store, like everyone is. Yes, I think for my wedding, I would like the three diamonds with the white gold. Oh my God, who's the clown that just walked in?
Did you have the face paint on?
Yeah, I had the whole nine yards.
I went for it.
If you're going to do something, you do it all the way.
Wow.
Yeah, and I walked in and she had a horrified look on her face and I gave her a bouquet of flowers, walked out and thought, that's probably not something I should have done.
She didn't have the reaction you were hoping for.
Not at all. And I mean, after I can tell you, I got exactly the reaction I expected.
What?
I never heard from her again.
I don't know why.
It's
kind of sweet though. I mean, I picture like this little young Charles like clomping through the mall with your big clown nose. The wilted flowers. That's sweet.
I was dedicated to the craft. Okay, so to change the topic, ready for a bad joke?
Yes. No. Yes.
No. Okay. If a clown eats another clown,
whoa!
What is that?
Clownopalopsy?
What?
I don't know.
Clownibalism.
Oh, see, I was trying to think of that, but I couldn't come up with it.
No, yeah.
On that note.
Okay, so I guess we should maybe wrap this up.
That's has been a weird day, by the way.
This has been a weird day. We won't go into it, but at least the podcast is done.
The podcast is done, and I think the clowns have not been on our side today.
That is true, but you know what? Our intro and outro music is... by
Moonlight Magic.
It's on the album Phoenixotica.
Check them out on Spotify. Check them out on Facebook.
Check us out online and all the social media. You can find all the information and show notes on our website at bloodyshed.com. And
thank you, everyone. We appreciate you so much.
And just remember, no whacking the Kraken on public TV, public access TV. Why are you looking at me weird?
No whacking the Kraken. Yes. So if anyone had any ideas of whacking the Kraken this weekend, don't do it.
No. No. Don't do it.
Terrible idea.
Okay.
Bye.
Was that a clown kiss?
No.